We're starting a series here called Get to Know. And so what we're going to do during this time is just kind of get to know the leadership of the church and start doing some things like that, just so you guys can get an idea and a feel for what we got going on here. And what a better way to start than those who have pioneered this whole thing, who have blazed the trail and got us to where we are today. So again, I'm here with Pastor Dale Buchanan and Teresa Buchanan, and I'm honored to be here with you guys and to just kind of take a few moments here and just have a conversation. And, you know, so I guess I'll ask you first, you know, this is maybe for people who are looking for a place to call home, who have maybe not been in church for a while, or who have, are just curious. I mean, who is Rio East Church? What's it about?
Well, the first thing I think that people need to understand is Rio East is a family church. And we are family, of course. And most of the people in this church are either family by relatives or family by blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And so thank you for doing this and letting us get our message out. But we're interested in people that are lonely,
yeah.
People that need a backup support. You know, even in the Bible, the Word of God says that we're not to go out alone. We're supposed to have, and it talks about how that if one falls, another can lift it up. You know, if one is lonely, another can comfort. And so that's Amen. Biblical. That's yeah. what we feel like a lot of the church is supposed to be about.
Amen. Teresa, I know that you're the quiet one, that you are behind the scenes and you hold your man up and you support him in prayer, but you also do a lot for this church. And I know that your love and your heart's desire is just to see people grow in the Lord. And why don't you just share a little bit about yourself, Teresa? Like, you know, I know everybody hears his loud mouth every Sunday and Wednesday, but they don't hear from you too much.
This is Mother Teresa.
Mother Teresa. There you go, folks. Mother Teresa. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Teresa. What's it like being married to this rascal?
Well, it was a God thing, that's for sure. That's too long to tell. We've been married almost going on 47 years. And when God called us into this, we were very surprised, but then we knew that that was what we were supposed to be doing. And here we are today and in a church that we feel like is a loving church. We want people to feel loved when they come through the door, so they can get connected, first of all, with Christ and their relationship. Mm-hmm. And anything that we can do to help them along that journey, first of all, just to make them feel like they're at home when they walk in the door.
Yeah.
And get to know them on a one-to-one basis and just keep growing in the Lord together as God yeah. has His hand on everything.
Amen. That's good. I know that my family and I are so grateful for you guys and for the love that we felt in this church the very first time we stepped foot in it. And I think that a lot of people out there, that if you give us a chance, that you'll feel that same kind of love and understand what we're talking about here tonight. But you know, we'll have a little fun here for a second, but what is, Pastor Dale, what is it about Teresa and her relationship with the Lord that just excites you?
Man, she's always been a stable fixture, and it's been because of the Lord, but all the way back for all these years, she's been the stabilizing force of our marriage. You know, I've been kind of hot-headed and off the rocker half the time, but she's the stabilizing force, just like Mother Teresa.
Yeah, I see where that comes
she
from.
She keeps us together. She's the glue.
Amen.
Yep.
So what about you? What I know we said a minute ago what it's like being married to this rascal. What's it behind? Let's peel the curtain back a little bit. We see the polished.
Get it too far over.
Well, hang on now. We see the polished version on Sundays and Wednesdays maybe a little bit, but yep. What's Dale like? Just in your personal point of view.
Well.
In his relationship with the Lord. How about that?
Strong.
Amen.
Stable, as he also said about me. But he's strong and dependable. And what he says he's going to do, he'll do it. And, you know, basically just the calling of God. He knows that is what he's supposed to do. it doesn't come without challenges, but it comes with God showing us the way, and He's my strength. God's my strength first, and then He's my strength.
Amen. That's good. No, this is good stuff, and you know, it's exciting to see. I've known these guys for a very, very long time, prior to even being under their pastoralship, if that's the right word. But you know, just seeing God just move and minister through your all's lives the way that He has, and to where we are today, and to be a part of that. So I'm thankful for that. And
Alf, we've prayed and continue to pray through all these years that God send people of diversity, mm-hmm. different gifts, different ages, different backgrounds, different colors. And the Lord does that here at East. And so we just want everybody to know that whatever your background is, you're welcome here. You know, you got people like Alf that are highly tech and do stuff like this video. And then you got people like me that are old dinosaurs that can only preach a little bit when the Lord anoints them. But we've got everything in between and so many different places that people can serve here at East.
I believe it, you know, and God has just been cultivating the ground, and seeds have been planted, and things are just starting to bud a little bit. And so now we need people to come in and help with the harvest here at Rio mm-hmm. East Church. And, you know, this is exciting times. And if you're not plugged in anywhere or doing anything, man, we encourage you to come. We have services on Wednesday at 7 o'clock. We've got things for all age groups. And even on Sundays, we got Sunday school starting at 9:30 and several different opportunities there to get plugged into. And then, of course, worship service at 10:30 a.m. And it's just a powerful time. I've never been to a service that I've not experienced the presence of God.
Amen.
And that's something I'll put my hand on the Bible to, and I can just declare that that's the truth. But, all right, as we end this little segment here, tell me something, Pastor, about yourself that nobody knows. Like, that would just be like, maybe it's a hidden talent. Maybe it's something that just, we all know that you're a coal miner or a rock finder, dog hound, whatever it's called. What's something about yourself that's kind of unique, maybe, that not most people know?
Well, of course, this is unrehearsed and didn't know about any of these questions, but the thing that just comes to my mind that jumps up is most people don't know that I used to take bass guitar lessons many, many years ago, and for a short time played the bass guitar in church just a little bit.
So did not know. It's the first time I've heard it.
I enjoyed that, and I thought that'd be something I'd want to pursue, but I guess the Lord had other plans, and got kind of caught up in ministry and went in another direction. So
love it. That's great. Well, you know you ain't going to get out of it, Teresa. Tell us something about yourself. That
she had time to think about it.
Well, yeah, she heard what you had to say.
I'm thinking and nothing comes to my mind.
Oh, there's something.
Well.
Pastor, help her out if you need to.
Maybe you might.
Now you are both like, what is this?
Well.
I don't know.
What's a little hobby or something that you like really enjoy that maybe you just kind of keep it close to your heart? What's something you're kind of passionate about outside of church and things of that nature?
Outdoor stuff is, if you want to say, you know, something along that lines. We like to hike and do kayaking and things of that nature.
She's a great kayaker.
Really? That's awesome.
I ain't turned over in one yet.
That's great. I've never done it.
We went up Citico Creek
years
back, and I turned over twice, and she didn't turn over any.
That's awesome. So she saved you, right?
Oh, yeah.
Grab hold of this. Yeah. Grab hold of this. That's
great. I also taught him how to water ski one time driving the boat.
She did, many years ago.
Awesome.
I liked killing him.
Kill me.
Love it. You a barefoot skier after that?
No.
I could have been the way she drove the boat.
That's awesome. Well, thank you guys again for your time tonight, and just for sitting down and being real, and just letting the people know who Pastor Dale and Teresa are. And I'm thankful to be under this leadership, under your leadership, and my family is too, and we look forward to what God's going to do in this church and the people that He's going to bring in to help with the harvest. And, you know, let's just lock arms. That's what we want to do. We just want to lock arms, unite, come together, and do some great things for Jesus, because we don't know the day nor the hour when he's coming.
Right. And we're so thankful to have you and your family, Al, yeah, for your talents. For sure. Looking forward to many more like yourself coming and joining with us. We'll get this thing done as time wraps up.
That's it.
It's growing close.
That's right. And we're gonna blaze a trail. We're gonna charge the gates of hell with a water pistol if we got to. But you know, there's a place for you here at Rio East. That's what we want you to know, that we have a place for you. So check us out. Spend a little time. Get on our website. Check out our social media platforms. And we'll look forward to having you in service. God bless you all.
Come see us, guys.
Yes.
You invite me to the table and you tell me just to sit and feel. Oh, the enemy may be all around me, but I'm running free, 'cause you set me free. Oh, the enemy may be all around me, but I'm running free, 'cause you set me free. Oh, the enemy may be all around me, but I'm running free, 'cause you set me free. I'm dancing on the grave, no one tell me about. I'm dancing on the chains that are laying on the ground. I'm dancing up the dark and lighting up the night, your joy becomes a weapon. Chains that are laid on the ground. I'm dancing up the dark and lighting up the night. Your joy becomes a weapon.
Everybody stand up. Stand up. Got a question. So in just a minute, I'm going to ask you to give the Lord some praise. But before you do that, I want you to hear this. Here's the question. If today, Keith, was your last day on earth, and you knew it, how would you praise the God that created 350 billion galaxies, created you, knows the hairs on your head, sent His Son to save your life? How would you praise Him? Now that's my God. Y'all go ahead and be seated. That's my God. He is amazing. Thank you guys for being here this morning. We're going to do the offering message. Here's another thing that I've heard this week and kind of learned, and is that we like to put limits on God. We like to not think He's who He is. I want to read you this verse in James. It's 4:2-3. It says, "You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You are jealous of what others have, but you can't get it, so you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure." You don't ask or you don't have because you don't ask. That's how we treat God, is because we limit God, right? He ain't that big, right? He can't fix that situation. He can't handle this stress that I'm going through. He can't do this. He can't do that. He's just God. No, He is just God, and He can do whatever He wants. He can handle every situation you're going through, but we put limits on Him. And we put limits on Him with our tithes and our offerings because we don't trust Him. God, if I give you my tithes, I won't be able to pay my house payment, and there's no way you can make that happen. Yeah, He can. He absolutely can. He's God. We got to quit putting limits on God. He said, I am. That's who He is. I am. You can put whatever you want to after that. He is everything. And He can do anything He wants. But we limit Him because we don't trust Him and we're not obedient. When we start trusting Him and we start being obedient, man, just imagine the things He can do. Quit limiting God. He is big. That's why we praise Him no matter what. Look, you got to make it here to church this morning. You woke up. You look good. You're breathing. A lot of people didn't get to say that. But we're here, and we're here to praise Him. And we're here to honor Him. Quit putting the limits on Him. Again, in this book that we're reading in some of the Sunday school classes, Crazy Love, it says He created 350 billion galaxies. Don't think He can't handle your situation. But when it comes to our tithes and offerings, all He says is give Him that first 10% and trust Him, and He'll do great and mighty things. So now is our opportunity. So they're going to play a little bit of music. Bring your tithes, your offerings forward. And there's, some people over here, some people over there that maybe didn't get to say hello to you yet. So go show them some love. All right, guys, if everybody could find your way back to your seats, please. Alf, brother, would you pray for the offering for us?
All right, guys. Father. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to sow into your kingdom. We thank you, Father, that you'll take this seed and you'll stretch it and multiply it and do what only you can do. God, I pray that you bless every giver. I pray that you bless their homes, Lord, their families, God. Those that are wayward and lost, God, I pray that you would bring them in. You know our hearts, God. And Father, as an act of obedience and as we sow into your kingdom, we ask that you would just use it like only you can. And God, we thank you for this opportunity. Bless the giver and bless the gift in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys. We want to welcome you. If you are a first-time guest or a visitor to Rio East Church, you are our honored guest. So right now, everybody, let's give them a round of applause, you know. Make them feel welcome. We love you. We're glad you chose to be with us this morning. And we got some great things in store coming up. But first, I want to tell you about this little information envelope that's around you somewhere. Find this thing if you're a visitor. Fill it out. And at the end of the service, please come to the Sam's Club room on your right out in the main foyer, and Pastor Dale and Teresa will be there to meet you, love on you. We want to get to know you. We want to connect with you because there is a place here for you at Rio East Church. You see, we want you to partner up with us. We want you to lock arms with us. We just want to do something good for Jesus. Is that okay? And we believe that it takes the body, the church, the people that make it up to do it. God uses people, amen? All right, well, guess what? We got some big, big stuff coming up. Got one more thing, and then we'll get back into worship. But on April the 8th, we kick off what we call Easter Fun Day. And so we put together a little slide to kind of show you what's going on. This stuff's on our social media platforms, so share it, because this is a community-wide thing. And we believe God's going to do a great work through this, a great ministry. And we just want to invite you to come. Go ahead, Eddie. There are some slides in here that have some sound. But check this out. This is on social media. Get on there and share it. April the 8th, Easter Fun Day. April the 9th, here at church for Easter Resurrection Sunday.
He said to let your light be set on a hillside. Set it up on a hill and let it be seen by all men. And that light is the glory of God. That light is the reflection of the Son of God as He shines through our lives. God has called us.
There's going to be some amazing things happen that day, and we want you to share this. We wanted to make sure that you're aware that it's available. Get on social media, share it, invite your family, friends, and your neighbors. God's going to do a great and mighty thing, amen? We've got to be active for the kingdom of God in order to do something different. In order for God to show up and show out, we got to be obedient, do we not? We got to do what He's called us to do, and we need you to help us. And so right now, we're going to go back into worship. I'm going to ask you to stand. And so, Father, we come before you humble. We come before you as servants. We come before you, God, as hungry people. You said in your word that those that thirst and hunger after righteousness shall be filled. And, God, we're asking you this morning to fill us. God, we're hungry. We're desperate for you. God, we know that there's a lost and dying world out there that you want to minister to. And, God, I'm asking you to use us. Help us to find those things within us, God, to bring them out, to bring them into obedience and compliance with your word and your will. And help us, Father, to chase after you because you're chasing us. God, give us that fire we need. Pour it out on us, Jesus. We love you and we worship you. In Jesus' name, and the church said, amen. Come on, if you want to worship with us, you're welcome to join around the altar here. Let's seek you.
Generations of air.
your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high, don't fear no evil. Fix your eyes on this one true, he's madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Oh,
Jesus, our redemption, our salvation. And yet he chooses to be our friend. You know, we've been reading this book, Crazy Love, and just like Brent was saying during the offering, it just shows you, reminds you of how insignificant that we are as people. We're his creation. He's the creator. And for some reason, we get it in our minds that we're in charge. For some reason, we get it in our minds that everything has to be the way that we think it has to be, when really, it's about us being, like he said, obedient. It's about us following the path that God has laid for us and worshiping him in the meantime. When we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but we praise him anyway. We don't know how this is going to happen or how this is going to work out, but we lift him up anyway, because the Bible says that we are to rejoice always. Always. And just like the children, we're gonna sing about it, but just like the children of Israel, God parted that sea. And they didn't know how they were going to get across it, but he did it. And not only did he part it, but he made it dry land. It wasn't even, they weren't walking through mud. They were walking on dry land. That's what our God does. He doesn't do things halfway like we do. He does them all the way. And so we're here to praise him today. We're here to worship him. We're here to lift him up, because he deserves our praise. He deserves to be worshiped. He deserves it. He earned it on the cross for us. He earned it when he sent Jesus to die. He earned our praise. Lord, you're worthy of our praise today. I heard this song the other day that said that our praise opens prison doors. Our praise opens prison doors. And I'm not talking about the Blount County Jail. I'm talking about the prison that the enemy has you in, or that you have your own self in. But our praise, just like Paul and Silas when they were in prison, they worshiped. And they were beaten half to death, but they worshiped anyway. And because of that, those cell doors swung wide open, and that jailer and his whole household came to the Lord because of their praise. So I want to encourage you today. You have somebody in your family that's wrapped up in addiction? Praise the Lord today. If you've got somebody in your family that doesn't know the Lord and they're wrapped up in the prison of their own self, praise the Lord today. Your praise opens prison doors. It might not be for your prison. It might be somebody else's, like that jailer and his family. It could be that it's for somebody else. So let's praise the Lord today, because he deserves it and he responds to your praise. Okay, let's go. Thank you, Jesus.
Won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance to the exodus of my heart. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh. Lord of every victory, hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep.
You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom, straight into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. 'Cause you
good God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Lord of every victory, hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep, hallelujah, hallelujah. doesn't already know. There's no problem too big. There's no weapon too strong. There is nothing for God that's impossible. There's no mountain too high, no valley too low. There's no fear that I have He doesn't already know. There's no problem too big. There's no weapon too strong. There is nothing for God.
There's no mountain too high, no valley.
We thank you, Lord, for your promises. Lord, we hold on to them today. We thank you that you are bigger and better and stronger and greater than anything that we could ever face because you are fighting our battles today. And we thank you, Lord, for the word that you've given Pastor. We ask that you would anoint him, God, in a mighty way, in a powerful way today, that you and your will would be done in this place, God, in Jesus' name. And I plead the blood of Jesus over every mind and every heart that is in this place, God. And if anyone's in here that doesn't know you, may they not leave this place until they have met you. In Jesus' name, we thank you for what you're going to do in this place. In your name we pray. Amen.
Man, what a presence of the Spirit in this house today. If you haven't felt the Lord yet, your wood's wet. We're going to pray that God help you to get into the anointing of God and let the blessings of the Lord flow. This wonderful job. Let's give the Lord a great hand of praise and appreciate this praise team. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I am amazed at how God confirms things. It's just amazing to me. Joy preached part of my message, and Brent preached the other part of it, and then they sang about it. And y'all hadn't seen my notes, have you, Joy? You've been messing around in my computer. Praise the Lord. I'm so thankful the presence of the Lord today. Don't lose this victory that's stirring in the house. Many of you have already been touched by the Lord, but there are a few here that still need that breakthrough, still need that victory. We can march in victory in this life. Did you know that? We can march in victory. I'm so thankful that out of, you heard him, 350 billion galaxies that God chose through the power of his Holy Spirit to be present here with us today. My goodness, I know he's everywhere all the time, but I'm so glad he's here. I'm so glad he's here, and I'm so glad that we can enjoy the presence of the Lord in this house. I know that lots going on. You heard a lot of that from Alpha. A lot of stuff's coming. Lots of stuff is going on in the church. Please keep yourself up to date with all of that. I know that this week RC is having a birthday, and a physical birthday and a spiritual birthday this week. I think Miss Carol Newbeck's birthday is today. And so if you're having a birthday this week, last week, the following week, we wish you a happy birthday. God bless you. I'm not going to sing to you this morning. I don't want to kill the spirit. So we'll just keep going. This week past, we had wonderful celebration out here in the parking lot. Second Harvest came. Some of you partook of that, and great groceries and food for people. There were cars lined up for over an hour, maybe 2 hours out here. Tremendous outflow, and the Second Harvest, we're so thankful to be a part of what they're doing here in Blount County. And then yesterday, our group also ministered to the hurting, to the homeless, to the needy folk here in the parking lot again yesterday through mobile meals. Some folks sat down and were able to eat a hot meal and then go home with groceries. And in that service or in that celebration yesterday, we had a precious lady rededicate her life to the Lord. And she's here this morning. Wave at us, Sister Sue, would you? Praise the Lord. We're so thankful for her. Let's give God a hand for that, would you? Praise the Lord. I'm glad that each of you are here. I noticed a few visitors that are with us this morning. We pray that God touches you and that you feel His anointing and His touch here today. There's a message on my heart, and I'm not sure exactly how that the Lord wants it brought out, so I'll just do the best I can to offer Him a vessel and let Him do the rest. Is that okay? If this walks on your toes, please understand I've not been listening in on your emails or your telephone conversations or your messages. I'm just listening to the Spirit of the Lord, and I know that this is from God. I started a few moments ago to say, okay, Lord, let's just have a worship service for the rest of the time that we're allotted this morning, and the praise team are anointed. People are circling the building. We've been in church. The house of the Lord has given praise unto the Savior. So let's just end it there and not go into the message. But then I got thinking about how that God orchestrated every song, and everything that's been said basically through leadership has led up to this message. So this morning, if you're here and you know the Lord is in your heart, I want you to not be discouraged. I want you to understand that during this pathway of life, problems come, situations occur, misunderstandings happen, upsets come down your way, down your pathway, sicknesses sometimes dwell in these physical bodies. The Bible talks about it raining on the just and the unjust. Brother Don, you're coming out of that. It's going to be all right. I see a shout of victory. I hesitate about even saying this, but I'm going to say it anyway because I feel led of the Lord to. But I was standing over here a few weeks back, and I was praying before the Lord and worshiping as the praise team was praising and worshiping and leading us in worship. And all of a sudden, I looked back toward those two doors. And I don't know if it was if my eyes were closed. I guess I was looking back that way, and I thought they were open. But I saw something like, have y'all ever seen a volcanic ash? Not the ash, but the lava as it runs down a mountain. Have y'all ever seen that? I saw coming through both of those doors what looked like lava. It looked just like glowing hot lava, but it was gold in color. And I said, Lord, what meaneth this? And I've been studying, and I've been trying to meditate on that and think about that. And the Lord led me to, well, what does gold really mean? What is it? And it means purity. Gold means purity. Gold means luster. Gold means beauty. And all I know to do is say there's beauty coming in the house. There's glory coming in the house. God is fixing to do a great thing, and I'm thankful to be a part of that. This morning, as we continue to grow in our lives, both spiritually and physically, hopefully every one of us, I know we have a group here this morning, several are above 55, several are under 55, and so especially to the young group, especially to those of you that are 20, 30, 40, those in that age group, as you continue to walk through life, it's God's plan, it's God's will, and the evidence is the proof in the pudding that we are to grow spiritually. We are to grow naturally. We are to mature both physically and spiritually. And as we mature, the Apostle Paul talked about it pretty straightforward. And he said, when I was a baby, I did baby things. When I was a little one, I did little things. It's time for all of us as we grow to put aside the childish things and to grab onto the things that's got some meat to it, to grab onto the things that we know that God is leading us to jump into. In planning a brighter tomorrow, we must anticipate the pitfalls and the potholes or the speed bumps that we have to encounter on the road to life. Life is not a pretty venture. Sometimes there's rotten things that we have to go through. Sometimes there's potholes that we run into. I've learned as I've matured in the Lord, both in Him and in this flesh being, I've learned that anything that's worthwhile is bound to be a bitter battle. Did you hear me? The more precious that something's going to be, the more wonderful that something that's going to be attained, the rougher the battle is to get to it. Somebody penned this. I don't know who it was, but I copied it from them. There was no name on it. But it said, the higher the hill upon which we build our castle, the harder the climb is to reach its top. It's hard sometimes to get up onto the top. It's hard to get to the place where our goals are set for. It's hard to get to that place. And now I want to bring you down home where we live. And you all know that the Old Testament, I understand that many ministers today have said that the Old Testament needs to be buried. It needs to be put back, put aside and not preached from. But I preach as much from the Old Testament basically as I knew the New Testament, because I believe that the Old Testament is a foreshadowing of the New Testament. I believe it all the way through begins to tell, even from Genesis all the way through Malachi. I believe the Old Testament is a picture of Jesus Christ coming. I believe it's a picture, and some of the things in the Old Testament haven't even happened yet. Some of the things in Jeremiah and Daniel are prophecies that are going to occur one of these days. But where I'm coming from is, you all remember the story of the children of Israel in Egypt's land. You remember that story. They got into bondage. They were there because of sin, but they cried out to the Savior, as they did so many times. They cried out to a Savior, and God sent them a Savior. And Moses saw the burning bush, and God instructed Moses, even though he said, God, I stutter, I don't speak clear. God, send me somebody to help me if I'm going to have to do it. And he sent him his brother Aaron. And you know the story. God sent Moses and Aaron down into the place of Egypt, down in, and as we think about that, we look into the New Testament, we think about that as our lives, and we think about how that we, before Jesus, BC, before Christ comes into our heart, we're in bondage, we're in chains, we're in slavery. The Bible says that we're dead unto sin. We're dead in trespasses and sin. And there are so many scriptures that give us that detail. And as we think about that, being in bondage, being in Egypt, and there was one day that God sent Moses down. He said, Moses, I'm going to use you as the deliverer for my people. I'm going to set my people free. That day came. After 10 plagues, after a whole lot of heartache, a whole lot of hardship, the day came when the children of Israel were to walk free. So now you've got the base for the message. I'm going to launch into Exodus chapter 16, and we're going to look at that here just in a moment. Just a simple, short three verses, 16, 1 through 3, chapter 16, 1 through 3 of Exodus. Father, as we think about your word this morning, as we think about your power, as we think about your love, as we think about your plan for humanity, God, help us to never camp where we're not supposed to be camping. God, help us never linger where we're not supposed to be lingering. God, help us to have a vision of what you want to do in our lives, both as individuals and as the church and as our families. God, help us never to settle for mediocrity. Help us never to settle, God, for that which is less than your goal, your desire, your vision for us as a church, as a family, as a Christian. Father, I lean on you this morning, and I pray that the power of your Holy Spirit will move through me, and let the words that come beaming and glowing from the throne today be spoken through these lips of clay. I'll be forever thankful in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Joy was singing about the sea being parted. The children of Israel were headed to the promised land. They were on the way to the promised land. They came out of slavery. They came out of a terrible, treacherous lifestyle. They came out of being beaten. They came out of being chained. They came out of being forced into labor, making bricks, finding their own material for the bricks. Long, long days, short nights, beaten in a terrible condition. They cried out to God. Can I tell you, the time that you spend in sin is a treacherous time. The time that you spend in sin without the presence and the peace and the joy of God is a miserable time. And can I tell you, there's another time that's even worse than the time when you're all in sin. And that's the time when you're splitting the fence. That's a terrible time. A backslider's life is a terrible, terrible time. But they were headed to the promised land. The children of Israel are headed out, headed to the promised land. But they went camping in the valley of sin. I was reading this scripture, and that phrase just jumped out all over me. Exodus 16. 1 through 3. And they journeyed from Elim. Who journeyed? The children of Israel. They were coming out of slavery, coming out of the oppression. And they journeyed from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin. Imagine that. A literal place. And here we are thousands of years later, Brother Doug, talking about that same place. Maybe not a literal place. I hope that you don't live in a city called sin. I hope that your house is not situated in a place called sin, or that you don't live on Sin Street, or that you're not in a physical location of sin. But the children of Israel, they camped there in the wilderness of sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after they departed from the land of Egypt, they didn't even make it two whole months. Month and a half from being free, they got into sin and they camped there. Verse 2. Then the whole congregation of the children of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. You know what the first thing is when you get into the land of sin? You know what the first thing is? Especially if you're a professing Christian, when you start camping out in sin, you're going to start complaining. It's one of the first things that happen. You'll start complaining. You'll be uncomfortable. You'll be discontent. You'll be dissatisfied. You'll be unruly. You'll be... Let's go on. The whole congregation of the children of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness, and the children of Israel said to them, "Oh, that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the pots of meat and when we ate bread to the full, for you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Remember, the children of Israel were on the road to promise. They were on the road to Canaan. They were on the road to the promised land. You and I this morning are on our road, if you're a Christian. We're on our road to heaven. We're on our way to glory. We're on our way to streets of gold. We're on our way to a place where no sin ever comes in again. But on that way, we must understand that pitfalls are going to come. And if we do find ourselves in the valley of sin, please, church, don't camp out there. It's only a passing day. Make sure that you run back to the cross. Make sure that you run back to Jesus. Make sure that you stay at the foot of the cross as you pass through the valley of sin. It's not a place that we need to stay. The next text that we read informs us that Israel was on their way to Canaan, and they faced bitter experiences all along the way. The ghost of hunger and thirst had raised their heads and frightened them. They were frightened to the extent that they began to think about the times when they used to sit by the flesh pots. They became discouraged before they had hardly gotten started. They'd been on the road just a few days and a few miles from Sinai, but yet because they'd missed a meal or two, they wanted to go back to the slave camps of Egypt. God had broken their chains, pulled a liquid gap out of a belching sea for a right of way, caused the wind to burn it dry, exchanged slushy mud for drifting dust, protecting their sore and tired feet, and yet they wanted to go back. Can you imagine? And yet they wanted to go make bricks from mud balls just to eat again at the flesh pots. Why? Because they were a selfish people that were looking to please self for the instant that they were living in, for the time that they were surrounded by. Isn't it amazing when we get uncomfortable? Isn't it amazing when we get in a situation that we don't understand, and all of a sudden we're saying, "God has forsaken me. God has abandoned me. I just need to go back to some of my old habits." You say, "Brother Dale, that never happens to good Christian people." Oh, yes, it does. It happened to Peter. It happened to James. It happened to the apostles. They went back fishing again when Jesus had left. And so do we. Sometimes when we don't feel good, we go back and we camp out in the valley of sin. "Brother Dale, you must be talking to my neighbor." Well, I pray that they get it. And while I'm talking to your neighbor, that your eyes and ears are open just a little bit too, because we all need it. They wanted to sell their future for a bite to eat. Seeing that freedom was quite a costly venture, they feared to pay the price. They had their eyes on Canaan, but their minds were in Egypt. They looked one way and thought another. They talked freedom, but they thought slavery. They were camping in the valley of sin. They started out watching God as He beckoned them through the clouds by day and the fire by night. Can you imagine every night laying down on your pillow, looking out the tent and seeing the presence of God as He was there beside the temple tent, as the fire was there and the presence of God protecting them, and every day having a cloud to lead them and to direct them and to comfort them from the sunshine. God was taking care of them. Then they came to the valley of sin. Things got a little hard. They wanted the provisions of God, but at the same time, they held on to Pharaoh's hand. Canaan and Egypt were in the same valley, but in extreme opposite directions. Let me say that again. Canaan, the place where they were going. Egypt, where they were coming from, were in the same valley, but in total different directions. Can I say that they were halted between the call of chains and the call of wings? Chains to hold them to their past, but wings to hold them to new heights. Chains of slavery or wings of freedom. Both places pointed in different directions. They were at opposite ends of the journey. Israel would either go back into bondage than to pay the price of victory. So many times we act like the children of Israel. We'd rather go back into bondage of the enemy than to fight for the victory. So many times we'd rather settle for the muck and the mire of mediocrity than strive for the pursuit and the possession of the promised land. So many times in the body of Christ we can't reach Canaan because we're simply too busy thinking about Egypt. Yes, our eyes are on Canaan, but many, many times our hearts are on Egypt. We camp out in the valley of sin. So the question today is, how, Brother Dale, can we break this vicious cycle? How can we get out of it? Up today and down tomorrow, looking to Jesus today for my salvation in the depths and the valley of sin tomorrow, because I don't feel good or look good or think things about me are doing just as they should. How can I get off the treadmill of life and go forward in the things of God? How can we focus our mind as well as our eyes on the Canaan experiences? How do we teach individuals promised lands? How do we look forward? I don't want to camp in the valley of sin. I want to head toward the promised land. How about you? So how do we do that, Brother Dale? We've got to adjust our focus. What is your focus on? Is your focus primarily on your problems around you? You say, Brother Dale, we can't help but focus on what we're faced with. Yes, but we have to have two focuses in life. One of them has to be our surroundings. And that focus, the older I get and the closer I get to home, the less in focus my surroundings are becoming. You see, I understand that this world is a temporary place, but I understand that my home is an eternal place. I understand that feelings are temporary. Did you know that your feeler will lie to you? Did you know that the enemy works through the feelings? Did you know that the mind is the battleground of Satan himself? Did you know he wants to come in and convince you that everything is going down the tubes? But can I tell you, Jesus said, come to me. Come to me. I'll in no wise cast you out. Did you know that Jesus said, believe and you shall receive? Did you know, like Brent was saying, if we'll get on board with what God is doing, if we'll push forward, if you want to go to the top of the mountain, you got to climb. Somebody said the other day, Brother Dale, you need to put a chair, one of them chairs that you hook to the wall and push a button to take you up to your office. And I said, no. When I start doing that, my legs will quit working. You got to climb to get where you want to go. You got to fight to get what you need. God has called us to fight the good fight of faith. He said it in His Word. He didn't say this will be an ice cream walk. He didn't say this will be a place where you won't face any problem. But on the other hand, He said Satan is as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Can I tell you this morning, through all the spit, God loves you. God cares about you, and God is fighting for you. And there's a team today that will tell you all you got to do is get your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life and sit down and ride your ship on to glory. But I came to tell you, I'm not here to debate or to talk about other people's ministries. I'm here to tell you what I read in the Word. And the Word says if you claim it, if you go out and get it, if you go out and get it, if you go out and do it, God will bless you with it. If you want to get to that location, you got to walk toward it. I'm not preaching salvation by works under no circumstances. But I am saying God never called you. He never saved you to sit and soak and sour. But He called you to get up off of your behind and start climbing the hill of maturity and start climbing the hill. He said, study to show thyself approved, a workman rightly dividing the words of truth. What are you saying, Brother Dale? I'm saying our focus needs to change. If indeed we serve a victorious God, we need to put our focus on Him and not on the fallacies and the problems of this world. I promise you, this world will let you down. I promise you, you may be happy. The Bible says there's joy in sin for a season. You might be happy for a little while, but I promise you there's no security in the valley of sin. I promise you there's no longevity in the valley of sin. One of these days, when people live their lives for the value that they can get in this life, it's going to be a sad existence when they come down to the end. I could read you story after story, application after application of people that I've studied, wealthy people, wise people. When they came down to the end, they were in the same boat as Solomon was in when he looked out and he said, it's all vanity because there's nothing here. But God said, when you seek me first, when you put me first, when you do what I've told you to do, when you climb that mountain, when you get out of the mully grubs and you decide the hill may get steep, but blessed God, I'll double clutch and grab another gear and go on to the glory of God. Brother Dale, why are you so wound up? Because I know in whom I believe, and I'm persuaded that He's able. I look at some faces this morning and I almost feel like you're singing that old, old song. I'm just suffering for Jesus. What good and glory do you think God gets out of that? I can't figure that one out. I'm just suffering for Jesus. I'm just praising for Jesus. You want to know the truth about things? I feel pretty miserable in this body. But you want me to tell you the real truth about things? God made this body. And if He wants it to wear out before I'm done with it, I'll exchange it for another one. Hallelujah. What am I saying? It doesn't matter who comes against you. It doesn't matter what you're facing in this world. It's temporary. We're just passing through here. And God's called us to get out of where we are and keep going toward the land of Canaan, the promised land. Say, Brother Dale, my promised land is when I get my new house. My promised land is when I get my new car. My promised land is when I get that 6'2" dark-skinned boy and he marries me. My promised land is when I get that beautiful hunk of a girl and she marries me. That's not your promised land. That's your battleground. Whoop! Children of Israel said, bless God when we get across the Jordan River, promised land. The old patriarchs, promised land, it's just across the river. Did you know that when they crossed the river, that was the first day that the battle really began? Did you know that it was fight, fight, fight for everything that you got? Did you know that for God to be glorified, they had to get out and fight the battle? I'm glad to tell you this morning that Jesus won the battle. You don't have to fight for your salvation anymore. But you do have to fight to keep the victory in the stinking flesh. Paul said, crucify it every day. Put your foot on it. Put your foot on the devil's head. Say, Brother Dale, did you call me the devil? If it fits. I didn't mean to. But the devil wants to work through you. Through your flesh. How many of you, don't raise your hands, but you've been... a little confused, a little disgusted, a little aggravated, a little frustrated, just this week, if you'd tell the truth. What happens when you camp out on that? Since you didn't tell me, I'll tell you. When you camp out there, that's what's going to consume you. Well, every morning I get up, I'm sick. Every morning I hear more news, somebody else in my family's sick. My bill's late on my car. My bill's late on my truck. My wife burned the bread for supper. And it's gloom, despair, and agony on me. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Go ahead and dwell in that garbage, and you'll have a miserable life. But Jesus paid an amazing price. There has been a Savior that's been sent from the portals of glory. As you think about it, God Himself came down in the cool of the day after He made man. Adam and Eve walked with God. They fellowshiped with God. But sin come in, and there was a severing there. And Adam knew that he was in sin, and he said, Eve, I'm paraphrasing, but you go read it. It's in the book of Genesis. He said, Eve, go back over yonder and see how many fig leaves that you can get to cover us up. And she went, and she made an apron out of fig leaves. She made coverings for them out of fig leaves. And Adam looked at himself and he said, Eve, go back and get some more fig leaves. You don't have enough. I'm still showing. I'm still uncovered. And God came down that same day and he walked in the garden and he said, Adam, where are you? And Adam said, I'm over here, God. I was naked and I hid myself. And God said, who told you you were naked? You know who told him? Satan told him, you're naked, you're undone, you're uncouth. But you know what God did? God said, let me tell you something, Adam. Them fig leaves will never do the job. But he said, temporarily, I'm going to fix it for you. And he went over and he killed a little animal. And he took that blood dripping skin and he put it around the shoulders of Adam and Eve. And he said, for a short time, this will work. It'll push back the sin for a short time. Throughout the Old Testament, we find that millions and billions of little animals were slain to put the coat around the spirituality and push back the sin for another little while. But it came to a screeching halt one day when God looked over at Jesus and he said, I'm sick up to here with the blood of animals and goats. I'm sick up to here. Somebody has got to pay the penalty for this sin thing. It's got to be done, and people can't do it. Who is God, Brother Dale? God became the sacrifice for you and me. The only lovely Son of God came to this earth. Paid the price once, your Bible says, one time. He paid that price. So all you have to do is come to the altar and put on that blood-soaked garment of faith in believing Jesus Christ has saved you from all sin. You say, Brother Dale, you mean I don't have to do works? No, you don't have to do anything but come and believe. But when you come and when you believe, James said, let me show you my faith by my works. This praise team, they come and practice. Most of them don't get a dime for it, but oh, they're getting written down in heaven, those things that they've done. Some of you, you came and you handed out food. And some of you are doing other things and teaching Sunday school classes and watching the babies and taking care of this and that. And God is taking notes and God is saying, I created you to do good works. Miss Joy, would you bring your team on? What am I saying? I'm saying the whole plan of God. The whole plan of God is before you this morning. And we, especially us comfortable folks in the United States of America. You know, I learn more every day as I get older and older, and I see more and more. And the Word of God said that it's going to be harder for a rich man to get into heaven than it is for a camel to go through the eye of the needle. And I thought, God, what meaneth this? And I don't know whether you realize it or not, but if you had a bed to sleep in last night and a floor to walk on this morning, a vehicle to drive here in today, you're in the world's top fourth most wealthy people. You say, Brother Dale, are you telling me it's going to be hard for us to get into heaven? It is. You know why? It's more than just saying, I believe in Jesus. It's more than that. Yes, that's a big deal, but that word belief is so much deeper than B-E-L-I-V-E. It's so much deeper and so much more encompassing than just a saying, I believe in God. And your Bible says, even the devils, they believe in God. We know they're damned. So what must I do, Brother Dale? We must believe to the point to where we don't hang around in the valley of sin, but we head toward that destination. We find the cross. And if it's too hard for you to live where you are, go to the cross. Go to that place in God where God said, come to me. I'll pull you together. I'll pull you in as a hen doth gather her chicks under its wings. He'll take care of you. He'll help you. He'll minister to you. But He never expected you to hang out or camp in a place called sin. It got them in trouble then, and it's getting the whole world in trouble today, by and large. We are comfortable in the United States. I thought about it didn't take me long to decide not to, but I thought about turning the heat off last night, Rose. And when people come in this morning, I can just imagine. I can already hear it in my ears. Instead of getting close together and worshiping God and thanking Him that we have a place in the dry, we'd have come in. Brother Dale, I'm going back home. It's too cold in here. I'm going home. And that's why I didn't turn it off, because I didn't want to preach just to Mother Teresa. But what God is saying today is, please, let's wake up. When we start flirting in the valley of sin, everything around us starts becoming our surroundings and our permanence. Your surroundings, Doug, is not your permanence. I think about you and the career that you've had and all the miles and the prairies and the rivers and the streams that you've seen. Brother Doug's been an over-the-road truck driver for all of his career, most of it. He's seen so much, but Brother Doug, I think about you. You always come back home. Where are we this morning? Do we always come back home to the foot of the cross? They're going to sing something. Would you stand today? I'm not sure. I have 7 pages of notes, and I've covered 2 of them. But it's time to quit right now. I'm not sure what the Lord is speaking to you today. I'm not sure what's going on in your life, but I can tell you this. If you want to go to heaven one day, you won't get there by camping in the valley of sin. Can I say that again? If you want to go to heaven one day, you'll not get there by hanging out in sin, because Satan will consume you, and you'll find more around you than there is out there where you're heading in your mind. So I challenge you. If you've been depressed lately, if you've been downtrodden, if the enemy's been wearing you out on your current surroundings, I challenge you to come to Jesus. Lord, there's no looking down our noses at anybody that comes to the altar. But on the contrary, that precious lady She told me yesterday, Miss Sue said, I've been needing to do this for a long time. But you see, somehow another life just keeps flying by, doesn't it? It just keeps flying by. It just keeps going. So fast. Come up here with me, Jossie, would you? So fast. 2.5 weeks ago, we just got to go visit her in the hospital, and she was a little baby. 2.5 weeks. 3 weeks ago, this one here was in the hospital. Coming up here, and we was marrying her and Jason and Joy. Time goes so fast. Now she's... It's getting there, isn't it? Or it may already have gotten there. I love you. But it's fast. Where are we camping? Let me promise you something. This generation won't get anything from you except negativity if you're in the campground of sin. And I'm not saying that you're out in sin. I'm not saying that you've turned your back on God. But I'm saying if you're camping, the children of Israel were headed toward the promised land. Now this bunch never made it because they camped too long in the valley of sin. That's another message for another time. But God led every one of them that come out of Egypt that was over the age of 20 years old, every one of them died because they camped out in the valley of sin too long. And they kept going round and round and round and talking bad about people and seeing their surroundings and wishing that they were back yonder. They didn't make it to the promised land. This generation won't have instructions when the battle comes. If you're in the middle of the battle now and you're giving glory to the battle. When the battle comes, that's when they look and say, if Pops can do it, if he can make it through, I can make it through. When they look and see that we're going through hell and high water and we're praying and we're seeking God and we're still praising God and they see that, that's how they're prepared to be able to make sure that they don't have to stay in this place called sin. I look at your babies. When you left here, how long has it been when you guys left? 3 years? 3.5 years ago? Man, they was... Now here we are. She's tall as you are. How long does it take? Thank you, baby. How long does it take in the valley of sin? How long is it too long? One day. How long's too long to camp out in the valley of sin, Brother Dale? One day. One day is too long. Jesus paid the price for you to be free. He paid the full price. He didn't say that you wouldn't have to walk through that valley, but he said on the other end of that valley is heaven. On the other end, if you'll keep going, you'll get there. Just don't camp out. There's some nuggets in this message, and it certainly ain't because I preached it. But the Holy Spirit is speaking to some people this morning. There's some people that's discouraged and distraught, and your kids and your grandkids and everybody around you are hearing what you're living. I'm challenging you this morning. If the Lord touches you, this altar's open. Go ahead, guys. I'm sorry. Come on to Jesus if you want to pray this morning. I'd love to pray with you.
Forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance to the exodus of my heart. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, 'cause you're the torn up. you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, 'cause you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, 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 oh.
You're the
to the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. 'Cause you're the God.